Now we're going to take a little bit of a little bit closer look at what the auditory system of the human being is made up of and some of the other effects that come out as a result of how it is constructed. Okay, so we'll talk about the cochlea. That will lead us into the third octave spectrum and then eventually into something called the bark scale. Okay, so this is the human auditory system that we're all familiar with. Ear, ear canal, eardrum, sort of sequence of bones that transmit the vibrations from the eardrum into this spiral-shaped organ called a cochlea, okay? And this cochlea has a logarithmic spiral shape to it, okay? And then you have all these nerves that touch the cochlea, and these auditory nerves would then go to the brain, and this is how the processed information from the cochlea gets sent to the brain, and then we perceive it as sound, okay? So if we are taking a little bit closer look at this cochlea, we have a nice logarithmic spiral shape. And if we were to map out the different frequency ranges of the cochlea, they would appear somewhat something like this, where the very, very tip would be 20 kilohertz. And then we would go down in frequency as we go around the spiral. And then the low frequency end of the frequency spectrum is in the inside of the spiral. Okay. And these are rough numbers, but if I were to unroll this cochlea into a flat on a table and look at these same frequency values, we'd see low frequency at the far right and high frequency on the far left. And then if we look at, you know, these intermediate 1 kilohertz, 3 kilohertz, 7 kilohertz, we notice that they're not linearly spaced here. Okay. There's a lot more linear space per frequency. This, let's say, you know, whether this is, let's say, let's call it 2 inches, only has to cover essentially 1,000 hertz over 2 inches. That same two inches over here is now 13,000 hertz, okay? And so our brain can't tell the difference between individual tones at the high frequency end as well as it can at the low frequency end. And it just has to do with how much linear space is devoted to each frequency on this cochlea organ inside our head, okay? And so what happens is the brain doesn't hear discrete frequencies, it hears groups of frequencies, okay? And so what we do when we use the octaves is we just take some narrow band frequency information. And we say from here to here, we're going to sum that up and we're going to report it as a single value right here at 2 kilohertz, okay? And then moving up in the frequency domain, we're going to then start where that one left off. We're going to start adding from there, grab a wider swath of frequencies, add those values all up, and then report it as a single value here at 4,000 hertz, okay? And typically, you notice that these octave bands or these bars get wider and wider, that you're doubling in width. When we look at the octave spectrum in terms of amplitude, we'll typically plot it on a logarithmic x-axis so that all of the green bars appear to be the same width. But you notice that each one is really contains the summation of twice as much frequency content as its neighbor to its left here, okay? So there's twice as much frequency content here as there is in the 1,000 hertz octave band, okay? And so we realize the brain is sort of grouping frequencies in these logarithmic buckets, if you will. And to make things easy on ourselves, when we decided how to set these octaves up, we just said, let's start out at 1,000 hertz and we'll divide in half from there. So we started at 1,000 hertz. There's always going to be a 1,000 hertz octave band in the full octave spectrum. And then essentially they said, just divide that by 2, divide it by 2, divide it by 2, et cetera, down to the lower threshold. So the 16 hertz octave band that incorporates all of these frequencies between 11 hertz and 22 hertz, okay? And then we double the center frequency going up all the way up to 16 kilohertz, and that 16 kilohertz octave band is the summation of all frequency lines from 11,360 all the way up to 22,720, all reported as a single value centered at 16 kilohertz, okay? Now, as we started working with these octaves, we realized, well, humans are better than this. We can hear more buckets of frequency than are illustrated by these, I don't know, 10 octave bands here or whatever it is. And so they divided each of these into three. And so that's how we get the 1/3 octave band. But you'll notice it's still centered around this 1,000 hertz octave band. And so every three is now a halving. So here's 1,000, 1, 2, 3, that's 500, 1, 2, 3, 250, et cetera. And so we're just taking this green octave band at 1,000 and splitting it into three parts. And these orange buckets, approximately 23% of the center frequency in terms of bandwidth, is the 1/3 octave spectrum. And these are pretty darn close to the groups of frequency that the brain hears in. Okay, so we don't hear a narrow band frequency, individual discrete tones. We hear in these groups shown by the orange bars and named by these sort of center frequency bands. Okay. Obviously, the frequency information is exactly the same. And so if I plot the same data in green narrow band, I can show you the same 1/3 octave band in the blue. And so you see this blue octave band here is the summation of all of these individual frequency lines here, okay? And I can also plot this in an octave plot. So now all the octaves will become equally spaced. And I'll see my green or my narrow band frequencies sort of spread out down here. And then they're going to get squished more and more closer together as I get up to the high frequency end. Okay. Frequency content is identical between these two. There's no difference. It's really just how do I want to display it. The blue bars are just sort of the chunks of frequency that our brain is roughly responding to. Okay. So we see this nice sort of almost Gaussian distribution in terms of frequency content, but we know that a lot of this amplitude is derived from these tones in here, and that will certainly have different sound quality implications for us further down the road. But in terms of amplitude, it doesn't matter whether these peaks are here in the narrow band or not. The third octave spectrum could be identical and could have zero peaks in this narrow bands frequency spectrum. Okay, so that's an important limitation of the 1/3 octave band, is it's sort of hiding some of the underlying what might end up being sound quality concerns for this frequency spectrum. Okay, so we use the 1/3 octave band because it's a nice rounded number mathematical tool to group frequencies into amplitude groups that sort of correspond to how the human brain hears frequencies and amplitudes. And it's a convenient way to model the frequency domain aspect of our hearing. It was originally developed by people who arbitrarily chose 1,000 hertz and multiplied by 2 and divided by 2 above and below that in terms of frequency. So it is a mathematically derived approach to it. When we look more closely at human perception in terms of frequency bands, that was sort of the focus of research that resulted in the critical bands or the bark bands. This is a much more accurate group. It's very, very similar to the third octave band, but it was all derived. They didn't care whether each octave band had the same width. They were more concerned with making sure that it was accurately modeling how human beings grouped frequencies in terms of perception. And so the bark band is divided up into 24. So you see bark band number 1 all the way up to 24. You see the center frequency here, 13.5 down to 50, and then the bandwidth. And you notice the bandwidth is not a nice round number multiplied by 2. It's pretty close to that, but it is different. And this ends up being a much more accurate way. So anything done in sound quality work, you'll be typically using the bark bands or bark's critical band rate.